This is a wonderful opportunity here because we get to contrast two different dialogues going on and see if you can like stay focused on this dialogue and not the band next door, the boys next door. Yeah. So let's say that today we wanted to finish off the day. No more path. Today's your final day. Well, how would you do that? How would you do that? And the way to do it, it's a little trick, is to say, I've already finished, actually. I've already finished. And we've gone over this quite a bit. Let me get closer so you can maybe hear me. I can't want to speak too loud. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to say, well, we know that we've already finished, and that's great, and we've been practicing that, but I want to go over a little bit of theory here, and we will do that, because this has come to light this morning. A way to look at what's going on here is the following. Our situation, what is our situation really? Our situation really is we're trying to convince God that there's this other realm and God needs to come to this realm and experience it. Why are we doing that? Well, we want to be greater than God. This is a whim we had. Let's be greater than God. And we realize that we're everything. So how can we be greater than everything? I said, huh, got a little problem here. And what we decided then is we decided that there was such a thing as less than everything. Okay, and that we're trying to drag God down into that less than everything so then we can be greater than God. So it's not, it's you know how the whole thing is like drag somebody else down to make yourself feel better? Like, so I'm better now because they're lower than me. We're trying to lower God down, so to speak, drag down God down into some lesser realm, a realm that's less than everything. But how do we do that? Because there isn't any such realm. There's only all it is that God created. Well, we're imagining there is such a realm, actually. And we're pretending that we're dragged down into it already. We say, God, of course there's a realm. Look at us. We're dragged down into this realm of determinism, where we're not free, where everything is already set up, nature and processes, time-space processes and form, and everything is happening to us, everything's external to our will, and there's a different realm, God. He said, you got to check this out. We say, God, this is an amazing realm. I mean, it's just so different. It's unbelievably great. You've got to come check this out. This is wonderful. And look how much fun we're having. Look how interested we are. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to dress up this realm, speaking of today's Valentine's Day 2015. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to say to God, God, look how happy we are here, God. And we're making it even better. Look how wonderfully attractive we can make this realm, God. You gotta come visit. You just have to come check this place out. It's amazing. This is what we're doing, actually. It's a very nice way of looking at what we're actually doing. We're trying to convince God there's this other realm, that we're in this realm, we're experiencing it, and saying, God, you're being deprived, terribly deprived, because you're not being able to experience this amazing realm here. Yeah, it's very different than reality, actually. You got to come check this out. I mean, it's like we didn't even know it was here, and we just sort of stumbled upon it. And you probably don't even know it's there either, because it was just kind of like on a whim, we decided, let's just try here, in a total whim, and lo and behold, this is what we discovered. And God, you probably aren't whimsical like us, but if you just have a whim to come see this, you'll realize, oh, it's there, really, it's there. So we're trying to con God into coming into this so-called realm, so that God will then be lesser in us and say, "Whoops, God, hey, we're actually all it is, and you're not, you see, and you're trapped, and we want to trap God in this realm." And of course, in trying to trap God in this realm, we're believing that it is possible to trap in this realm, to be trapped in this realm. Okay. So since we want to trap God in this realm, we believe being trapped in this realm is possible. And here is the trouble. You're starting to see the trouble, so we're not going to go too fast here. But here is the trouble. See, we're believing, yeah, this is the this throne is a trap. We can be trapped here. There is a way to be trapped here. And in fact, we're feeling, and how do we know? Because we feel trapped here. Of course, if we feel trapped here, how do we get out? And we say the only way that we can get out is when God comes in to this realm and is trapped in this realm. That will automatically sort of magically unlock us from this realm. That's the key that we think will unlock us from this realm. So that's why we're all trying to get God into this realm. Now, how do we make this realm attractive enough to get God in here? This is a problem we have because God has not come into this realm. And we think, what do we have to do? And what we do is we imagine an imaginary God as a prop who is telling us how to do it. So we think that there's a God that is knows how to get the real God to come into this realm so we can trap the God in this realm and we can be greater than God. And we then pray to this God, worship this God, ask this God, please inspire me, please inspire me. And because we think the only way we're going to get free is if we can get God to come here and trap God here. So we need some God who knows God, how to trap God. So we've imagined this all-knowing God who knows how to get God to come into this realm and be trapped in this realm. And so we worship this God, we pray to this God, we believe this God is all-knowing and can save us. You can say, okay, just listen to this and just hear it. Okay. It's better than listening to those boys, huh? I'm not sure that they're talking exactly about this stuff right now, but this is I would say, is very, very relevant. And it's just like, wow, we just realized, oh, wow. And it's okay. It's just, this is the full stop in the wow. Oh, wow. Hearing this, it's just, I'm hearing it for the first time, actually. Just because I was willing to share as much knowledge as I could today with you, and somehow this allowed this to come up. So I'm hearing this for the first time, this clearly. And it's like, oh, wow. Oh, wow. Yeah, that's what's going on. Now, if we gave up the desire to try to be greater than God, would we then need to believe that it's possible to be trapped in this realm, to trap all that is God and us too? We are God too. If we gave up the desire to trap God and we said, oh, you know, no, I mean, to be greater than God, wouldn't it then we would be able to look at this world differently, and we might not be so biased, and we wouldn't have this preconceived insistence that it's possible to be trapped here? And if we gave up this preconceived insistence that it's possible that this place can trap and will trap under the right circumstances, if we gave up that preconceived premise bias, couldn't we not then see this whole situation differently? And could we not see that this actually isn't even, one, you can't be trapped here, actually. Two, since we can't be trapped here, we're not trapped here, right? We're not trapped here. And three, since we're not trapped here at all, isn't it easy to see this is not even a realm at all? As Shankara said, world seen as world is false. World seen as God is true. Okay. So we can just full stop in the wow. We don't need to try to prove that we're intellectual giants by scrambling the top of the mountain right away. No, we realize the import of what we're talking about here, which is even greater wisdom. You know, who's smarter? The one who thinks that they need to charge all the way to the top of the mountain in one charge just to prove how smart they are, are the ones who say, hey, wait a minute, there's a tremendous amount of continuity fear here, and I can feel the massive import of what we're talking about. And I think it'd be way smarter to just get a feel for that and let that settle in and feel okay about it than it would be to try to charge up that mountain. So you know, what's actually smarter? So what my assertion is, it's smarter to do the full stop in the wow It's smarter to acknowledge a continuity problem, which means a familiarity problem. I can see now how it's possible to see this world not as world, but world as God, you know, and be free. And wow. See, if that's not a wow, what is? So we don't need to immediately charge to the top of the mountain. This is the smart play, not the boastful play. I'm just stunned by this right now. I came across this quote by Shankara last night. I never heard this before, and he was basically saying, just condense all his teachings. World seen as world is unreal. World seen as God is real. And I saw, exactly. And why do I need to talk when these guys are doing such a great job? Let them have their say too. And keep in mind that our considerations are done in a world full of commotions, of people desperately following this imaginary God's advice of how to make this world suitable so it can finally attract God into it. You see, finally attract God into it. So everybody is quite busy with that endeavor. But I'm saying, what if we gave up our desire to be greater than God? We wouldn't be biased, would we? That insisting that this world can trap God. If you say, well, it's trapping us, so you can trap God too. But isn't that a premise that we're using? Is that actually true, or is it a premise that we want to be true? And since this whole reason for imagining this realm is to be greater than God, isn't it then a premise that we have, that we want this to be a trap that actually can trap God? This is something this is our goal. Okay, so it's a basic premise that this must be that way. But if we give up the desire to trap God, can we not also say, you know, well, look at the world objectively and say, well, maybe it isn't a trap, that we just so strongly desired it to be a trap that we overlooked all evidence that it wasn't. Well, obviously, we don't have to keep speaking of it. It's obviously, the wow is already there. Once the wow is there, we don't have to explain it. That confuses it. Obviously, it's already been laid bare. I already laid it bare, and just like, wow. So I just have to maintain discipline. I'm trying to remember what I said, but no, the wow is already there. And don't try to go back and remember, you know, what was said. That was a little mistake on my part there. I was charging up the mountain a little bit. I just stop for a while here. Is this sufficient? We're realizing, you know, or freedom, but what's more important is settling into the shock of how easy it was. So that's what's important, is look how easy it was there just to undo the entire thing. And in trying to remember what I said, I'm trying to make it more difficult. You see, the shock is how easy it is. The shock is how easy it is. So we try to complicate it. The intellect is very good at complicating matters. The whole psyche, our whole defensive system, emotions, intellect, the whole thing is very, very skillful at complicating matters. So what we just did here is just show to just how incredibly easy and simple it is. And since we set our goal, what if today was the day, our final day? Well, we need to make it real simple and easy, right? So we just did. We just did. So the discipline here is full stop in the wow of just how simple and easy it is. And don't try to remember. That makes it more difficult. That was a little mistake I made. Maybe that was a good way to show you. Example. This is a mistake. And don't make that mistake. So it's more important to let the shock of this reverberate through us. Once you see how actually incredibly simple and easy it is, then that, let that shock reverberate, and don't try to remember what was said. Don't try to recapture it. Say, oh yeah, I want it to be really easy, so I'm trying to recapture. No, we already heard it. I already heard it. Just like, boom. You say, oh my God, it's that simple. So getting used to how simple it is the key. Getting used to that. So yeah, I do know the answer. I've already seen the answer, which is true now, isn't it? We've already seen how simple it is. And our mind, the mind is trying to make it more complicated. That's what I'm seeing. The mind is saying, no, it can't be that easy. No, it can't be that easy. I'm not ready for that. It can't be that easy. It is. It is that easy. So, of course, our minds are going to try and complicate it a little bit, right? But we want to minimize that. This is what it's called full stop in the wow, is to minimize the spin that we put on it. It really is that simple and easy. And so enjoy the shock of that. Enjoy the shock of it. So really, most teaching is spending time in this wow, full stop in the wow, getting used to the shock, because it really is that simple. And so what we're doing is we're progressively getting used to how easy and simple it is to resolve this so-called dilemma that we're in, this so-called trapped in a so-called realm. Separate realm and all this stuff seeming so difficult, we think, but actually we're progressively realizing how absolutely simple and easy it is. And of course, if we want God to believe if we want to believe that being trapped, God, we don't want it to be simple and easy to get free. No. We want once God's trapped, we don't want God to ever get free. Because we don't think God will punish us, you see. So we're afraid of a future punishment. To expand upon this a little bit now. What we're saying is, yeah, we can get God to come here and trap God. But what if God gets free? Worried about that? I'm worried about that. Or God will be so angry that God is trapped that that fury will somehow reach us, you know, where we are. And so we're trying to imagine that we have this very angry God who's, you know, threatening to annihilate us and everything like this. And no, we'll be good, God, we'll be good. We're trying to see, how can we placate God's anger at being trapped? Trying to figure that out ahead of time. Yeah. We're just thinking, boy, when we trap God, God's going to be furious. You see, God can't get out, eternally trapped. He's going to be absolutely raging. And we're afraid of that. So, oh, God, God's rage is going to be so extreme. You know, we've got to simulate that. Let's simulate it ahead of time so we know how to deal with it. So this is just like a new theory, like a mind-blowing new theory, and you can just feel the ramifications of it. You know, just like, oh wow, from this standpoint, it's all very easy to resolve. The whole thing can just be easily set down. It's just, so don't try to set it down. No, because what we're really concerned about is the ease of setting it down, you see. And we're thinking, if we can set it down this easy, then can't God set it down this easy too? Oh yeah, but maybe it's totally easy to set down. And if it's totally easy to set down, then isn't it the fact that God isn't trapped in it at all? That God's already set it down. And therefore there's no reason for God's anger, to fear God's anger. See, they go, wow. So there's definitely a feeling of wanting to like sort of disengage and flee from this. It's too clear. It's too simple. So this is the struggle. When we say, well, I don't have a teacher, I don't have anyone to help, nobody. Well, you would flee. We flee from that because it's teachers already realized the complete simplicity of it. The effortless simplicity of it. And you're saying, no, I don't want that. That's too much. I want to get him some distance away from that. And so, of course, in interactions with any teachers, we're going to try to make it more complicated. It's like I say, you're not saying this, or I think on this, that. And what we do is we complicate it for ourselves so we feel safe. But what I'm saying is better to practice full stop in the wow. This is how you actually succeed. The other way you're not going to succeed, you're just battling with the teacher, saying, well, you're trying to make it simple for me, but I'm not going to let you. I'm going to keep it complex. You know, you're trying to trick me. I don't know. You think that trick is still there, trying to trick, trick God, trick this. But if we just say, okay, no. Let's do it this way. Full stop in the wow. Like, wow. The simplicity of it is shocking me. Great. Let me just rest in that. Then you're not battling the teacher. See, you don't bring this ego in, so to speak. You don't bring the problems in. You say, oh, it's becoming simpler, but I'm shocked by it. And then, yeah, that's right. Just then full stop in that. You don't need to act like you're here for information. You already got a taste of the ease of it. And then that's sufficient for right now. I'm convinced that this is what works. I'm convinced that this is why I'm doing it. Having done the other way, it doesn't work. This way, I can. It's obviously working. to just get to this new, entire new way of looking at it, just like that, and then to look at it and see how simple it is, that means it's working. Because a mind that was afraid of simplicity and ease could not see it that way and hold it carefully, hold it enough to really explain it and see it. They would complicate it and they wouldn't be able to see it. So this full stop in the wow is working. Wowism works. Maybe that's the new motto. Wowism works. Yeah. Double meaning of works, because we work at it, don't we? Yeah. Now, the intellect will say, loves to say it's not shocked at anything. I can't be shocked. I can't be shocked. Well, that's fine. We're not trying to shock the intellect. But I'm spiritually shocked. The intellect says, well, why? The intellect says, I'm not shocked. Why are you shocked? And we say, well, the intellect, well, you don't really matter. So whether you're shocked or not is irrelevant. The intellect is just like saying, God, there's no problem here. Come on down. Come on down. Tell them what they won, Johnny. God, you have won a super duper ecologically friendly, everlasting, automatic, you know, beautifully designed new realm for you. Yeah. Come on down. You're a winner, God. So the intellect says, no problem here. There's no problem, no problem. I'm never a problem. That's irrelevant. The intellect's irrelevant. It's spirit that's shocked. It's the experiencer. The intellect never experiences anything. It's the experiencer that's shocked. This is what we have to respect. This is respecting ourselves. The intellect always says, well, I can pull you out of that shock. I'm not shocked at all. Well, of course, you can use words and then say you're not shocked. You can just string some words together. What is that? That's actually a response to shock. The experience of being shocked turns to the intellect. You know, when people are in shock, they often sort of just try to talk, and try to say, I see, I'm not shocked, I'm talking. I'm not shocked, I'm talking. But they're still, you know. So what we do is we say, no, I am shocked. Absolutely, I'm stunned. And this is great. So there's awareness of being stunned. We don't try to talk ourselves out of it so much. What we do is we appreciate it. Respect it and appreciate it. Say, this is a symptom of getting well. This is a symptom of getting well. This is a positive shock. It's not a traumatic shock. See, is it traumatic? No. We can tell the difference between some sort of traumatic shock and a positive shock. And we say, this is a positive shock. One moment, please. All right, well, that was a very aggressive interruption, to say the least. Wow. So, must be really getting somewhere. Must be ringing the bell of the whole situation, that is for sure. So when we full stop in the wow, we're not panicking. We're accepting that we're shocked. But when you consciously accept it and embrace it, you don't panic. And when you panic, that's when you go into the intellectualisms and the spin and fantasies and thinking, recollecting, trying to figure this out. We don't do that. We embrace the shock. Say, okay, great. Full stop in the wow. Wonderful. We don't try to make it greater, to objectify it or lesser. We just kind of realize that just to let it settle in is enough. Just trust that there's the resilience within us to let this, to accept this. Oh yeah, okay. We can get familiar. I can get familiar with this. I can get familiar with this level of simplicity and this level of ease. I can get familiar with that. This is where I'm dwelling right now. This is my new our new camp. You see, if we charge forward too hard, what we're doing is giving ourselves an excuse to retreat away from where we already are. In other words, to never give up the progress we've already made. This is what I've found throughout the lifetime of working on this, is we get into the shock and like, oh my gosh, that's so easy, simple. And we say, I'm scared. What do I do? I don't want to admit that I'm shocked or anything. So we bluff and say, no, I'm not shocked. Okay, let's go for the top. Let's storm the top here. And then at that point, say, oh, it's too difficult. Oh my, I don't know what's going on. And then retreat. And then you go panic, retreat, and you go past the place where you've already gotten to, and try to go far away from it. You know, it's just an expression of our fear of where we're already at. So we don't want to go into this bluff mode of charging ahead. We want to recognize this shock of where we're already at and say, okay, let's just get used to this. This is the discipline. It's a required discipline to make progress. We can spin our wheels and make a big show of it, but we're not into that anymore. We've been there, done that. We don't really have a lot of time to waste on that kind of stuff anymore. So we're not going to spin our wheels. We're going to maintain traction. So I asked the Holy Spirit for help. The Holy Spirit gave help. And I'm stunned by it. Wonderful. So while it may seem that to charge ahead like the hare, jump ahead, is the right way, so we don't want to waste any time to jump ahead. No, because then it suddenly panics and turns around and panic retreats, and we lose ground. So it's kind of like we say, okay, let's pause, have lunch, you know, relax for a while. Let's not even focus on too much on the objective, because the objective is just to settle into where we are right now. The Holy Spirit just proved that it can deliver the goods, right? So we don't need to say, oh, wait, the Holy Spirit's not going to keep it from us. You know, we got to grab it now because it's going to disappear or something. No, have faith in the Holy Spirit. Put your faith in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can bring our attention to what we need our attention on easily. It will do so. When we're ready for it, and the way to be ready for it is to take a little break right now. Relax. Just because we're farther along now doesn't mean the upset should be greater. Because keep in mind, we've already evaporated a lot of the continuity fear already. So it may be just that it's intense, but it's not, you know, super intense. Not too bad. Strong. It's strong wow for sure. But that's okay. We can tone it down a little bit is to say, I've already succeeded in accepting this. This is our little trick. Since this whole thing is a trick, one trick deserves another, right? So, and it's actually true also, but it's time saver, so to speak. I know I've already understood this, and I've already got it. I'm already comfortable with this. I've already succeeded. This takes the edge off of it. And since we've already accomplished it, we don't need to explain or talk about it. It's already done. If something's already done, it's water under the bridge. Not worried about it. History, it's already water under the bridge. I've already gotten used to it. So we're just getting used to the fact that we've already gotten used to it. Kind of takes a little edge off of it. So I'm getting used to the fact I've already gotten used to it. Rather than struggle with what we, you know, what we said, the insight, it's already there. It's already there. I already have it. So I'm already used to it. You say, I'm already used to it. But I'm getting used to the fact that I'm already used to it. Or getting used to the fact that I've already gotten used to the fact that I'm already used to it. You can kind of look at it that way. And you can go into infinitely with that. Infinite regression or infinite chain. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully have gotten used to this. So the wow kind of gets transferred over to, wow, I've already accepted this. I know I already successfully know that I've already successfully accepted this. I've already accepted it successfully. I've already accepted this. Wow. I've already accepted this. Whew. This helps keep our mind off of trying to spin what we were talking about, which is what we really want to avoid for sure. So we say we don't need to do that because we know you're already successfully, I know we already successfully know you've already succeeded. That's the issue that I'm looking at. Wow, I've already succeeded. Settle into that well. So it's kind of a 1-2 punch we're delivering here. The first wow, and then we sort of transition to the next wow that we've already gotten used to. The first wow, it's already done. We succeeded. It's easier for the mind just to be quiet when you do it this way. So when the mind tries to say, no, wait, you know, what did I succeed at? No, I've already succeeded at it. I've already accepted the fact. I've already succeeded at it. I've already accepted the fact that I have succeeded at it. So it's already done deal. It's finished. There's no questions. So we're just concerned now. We're trying letting how does it feel to have already succeeded? Trying to allow that to. To start maybe a little tinge of that, like, hey, this is great. When people find out they won the lottery, they say, I can't believe I won, I can't believe it. You know, it's such a shock. You know, so we're saying, yeah, we already won. And so we're allowing ourselves to get over the shock that we won. You know, we've already won. It's already done, it's already finished. It's already over, it's already understood. We did it. And so here we are with the winner's check, you know, the balloons and we're like, oh my gosh. And so this is where we already are. We've got the winner's check and the balloons and the confetti and the band and everyone's like, how do you feel? You know, it's like, I can't believe it. We're trying to compose ourselves, struggling to compose ourselves. I've already won. How's it feel? They say, how's it feel? And people say, I can't explain it. I don't know. Yeah, don't know. So of course this is a tough one. We always imagine ourselves, when we win the big prize, we're going to be very eloquent, you know, and thank everybody and eloquent. No, when you get here, it's like, you're stunned, you're shocked, I've won, I've already won, it's already finished. Thank you. So what we're doing is we're now turning our attention to what's the feeling that's going to come. What's the feeling now? What's the breeze? What's the scent of the breeze? I just got a brief, tiny, faintest little glimmer of that, you know. This is now we're turning our attention to that. It's kind of like the victor's wreath. We're wearing the victor's wreath. And we're so stunned we don't realize how beautiful it smells. And the victor's breeze is already with us. And we're not aware of it because we're so stunned. But we need to now start realizing, oh, this is how it is. Realize deep down that everything is now fresh. Everything is entirely fresh. Freshness arising from freshness. That this is the actual condition of everything. We don't have a world as world. We have freshness appearing as a world. That's all. So as much as possible, we're sort of allowing ourselves to imagine, or, you know, what is that going to feel like? How is that going to feel? And we tell ourselves we are feeling that. We're just unaware. So temporarily, we're kind of confused, a little bit shocked, but we are already feeling it. So the real progress is in the silence of maintaining your position and not panicking. This is where the real progress takes place. Just get used to not turning to your analyzing, your emotionalizing, They're dramatizing the spin, all the spin. Don't turn to all the spin. Stand your ground. Again, the posture, feet on the ground, sitting straight, head up. You're not crushed, you're standing your ground. Let all the shadows flee. You're not fleeing, you're standing your ground. And of course, it doesn't do much good to stand your ground for just a few moments and then flee. So we like to stand our ground for quite a long time. And then that really settles in that, hey, I really am standing my ground. So this basic process we have here can be used with any wow, or whatever happens to trigger wow. If this didn't trigger, something else will. Same process, you stand your ground. Let whatever flee, let it flee. You don't need it. So I don't need these tricks to flee or whatever. Let that go. I'm standing my ground. I'm staying here. It's like you have all these companions with you and someone want to leave. Say, well, go ahead. I'm not leaving here. I'm staying right here for now. Some say, oh, come on, we want to go forward. They're the ones who actually are trying to find an excuse to retreat from where they already are. Oftentimes, yeah. So those want to go forward, let them go forward. Those want to go back, let them go back. You just stay pretty much right here until you're comfortable with it. So we're here in the shock of seeing there is a way to look at it very simply and easily resolves the whole thing. Solves the whole situation. Boom, one, two, three. And we're capable of looking at it. There is a way to look at it. We're capable of looking at it. And now we're just standing our ground here. It's like someone gives you, you get up in the morning and you go outside Valentine's Day and there's a brand new car in your driveway. It's like, oh, wow. Huh. You know, you just don't say, oh, great, the keys, oh, wonderful. Okay, now let's go on. What's the next gift? No, you just let it settle in, right? At least for a while. Because this is, you know, a life-changing event. Something is like, wow, I just got that brand new super modern SUV, you know, whatever, and it's just this, you know, I'm going to feel, you know, driving this, and it's just going to be different. Wow, it's going to be really something. So you just don't bluff and say, oh, yeah, it's no big deal. And no, it's a big deal. So accept it's a big deal. This is a big deal. Getting to this point where you see it so simply is a really big deal. You don't have to be singing those sad songs anymore, right? You realize those songs are over. The ramifications are huge. My sad song is over. Will we drive the car immediately? No. Maybe just let it sit in the driveway for a couple days and get used to it. Go look everywhere and check everything out carefully and just get used to the fact it's yours. It's there. It's there. You don't have to prove anything. You have to go out driving, test drive and prove it. It's yours. And just let it sit in the driveway. Maybe for a week or so. There's no timetable. Maybe a month. Just let it sit there or whatever. There's no timetable. No timetable. Maybe one day you'll just say, oh, I need to go down to the grocery store. Oh, okay, I'll just turn the car and drive, go down to the grocery store and drive it back. Oh, yeah, great. There's no hurry to do anything about it, really. Just let it sit there. The neighbors get used to it, you get used to it, and gradually, you know, you get used to it. It's like a brand new driveway. You get a brand new driveway, and for a while, it's just like, wow. I don't want to drive on it, I just want to look. And after a while, you just get completely used to it. And it gradually you get completely used to it. But we don't want to say, oh, that's no big deal, and try to bluff our way. No, those who try to bluff their way say it's no big deal, it really means they're overwhelmed by it. So we don't want to be overwhelmed by it. We're not overwhelmed by this. But it's a fine line. We certainly know this is a huge deal situation going on here. But we're not overwhelmed. See, that's a fine line. And what makes a difference? Our choice, our willingness to be a little patient here. See, we want to remain functioning just the way we're normally functioning and everything else, so we just want to stay calm and not get overwhelmed by it. So we're choosing to not be overwhelmed, but all at the same time recognizing it is, you know, extraordinary. Let it kind of deepen and it becomes more intense. But since we're already used to the intensity to a large extent, that's okay. It's kind of like thawing out from frostbite. You don't want to go too fast, but you don't want to stay frozen either. So you say, okay, come on, yeah, it hurts, but it hurts good. Let's get the circulation back. So if someone really wants to get back to functioning, they want that frostbite, they need to thaw out. They don't want to get permanent damage, let it thaw out. They say, okay, I can put up with some of the suffering here. Let's get it going. Let's keep it going faster. So if they froze it again, then they could just pretend it doesn't exist and say, yeah, everything's fine. But it's not. It's still frozen. So you have to go through this sort of the suffering of letting it thaw out. course. The regrets of, you know, I could have always seen it this way. Yeah. Wow. But we sort of understand. Oh, I can see how I tricked myself. Yeah, I can see how I tricked myself. I was trying so hard to trick God, I tricked myself. But that's what happens. We see that and say, oh, okay, so that's what happens. Okay. One moment. Okay. So, there has to be this willingness to go through this ordeal, kind of sweat lodge ordeal, in order to make real substantial progress. Because real substantial progress is going to point out how obviously easy it is. And that is going to really carry a shock value with it. The willingness to do this is oftentimes based on the fact that if you don't do it, you know you're going to suffer a lot worse. Right? Really. This is why these times are so helpful to us, actually. These are very helpful times. Don't squander this epoch in the world. Because the world is going into such a bad direction, so terrible, we realize, hey, if we don't do this, we're going to suffer a lot worse. So that is a great, great motivator. These are great times, actually. Look at it that way. I thank the situation for being so terrible. It's like, yeah, the television, everything I could do is so horrible, so obviously ruinous, that I say, I can't do that. And so I got all this time to do what? To do this. So it's wonderful. If there was a bunch of wonderful shows on wonderful distractions, everything's fine, I say, oh, that's it. Yeah, this is no problem. I can do this. But now you realize the viciousness of it. And it's revealed its nasty side. You know, there's a sort of a really nice, polite, like a waiter. You know, the waiter's so professional and polite. But then there's another side to it, you know, it's like really angry and angry and upset. And when that side comes out, you say, oh, this isn't good. So you avoid it. So this is a huge motivating factor right now, is the extreme situation as this world gets incorporated into, and that corporation has all sorts of rules and regulations and beliefs, and that you have to follow those, actually. It's really not a very free situation at all. And so you say, well, I can't do that. I've got to do this. And today is another, it was 82 yesterday. It's going to be just as good or better today. It's just like an absurdly beautiful day in California. But here I am suffering like this. Just the full shock of the wow. Just wow. Because this, it completely transcends any nice weather day, nice place, nice situation, it absolutely transcends importance, totally. You know, so this is a no-brainer. Imagine if you're trapped in a world of this, like, constant radio. This is your mind. Imagine if that radio was your mind. Is that what you want, you know? Good Lord. This is most people's minds. This is the content of their minds at this, like that, like the radio. Just driven through life, you know, driven through and this whole agenda, driven along with this agenda. You know, hey, we gotta dress this place up. We gotta believe in it. We gotta believe in it. We gotta believe in it. If we don't believe in it, how can we get God to believe in it? Gotta believe in it. Gotta believe in it. Gotta use every possible technique we can to believe in it. Because see, God, we think the problem is we're not believing it enough. So God looks at us and says, "Is that really real?" And God's got some doubt. We think so. We just gotta believe in it more, and we'll be saved. If we just believe in it more, we'll be saved. And so we use all these expedients to just super saturate ourselves with believing in it, believing in it, believing in it. Oh yeah, absolutely. This is a separate realm. Oh yes, absolutely. It's all external to our mind. There's nothing we can do about it. So it's all set up and running on its own. You know, it's just here, all running on its own. And yeah, I believe it. And so we just inundate ourselves with this conditioning. To believe in this, believe in this, believe in this, inundate ourselves. And so we spend life after life after life after life just being inundated by inundate. The difference is we don't say this is absolutely shocking. We say it's very shocking, but not absolutely so. So there's part of us that's aware, that's breathing, that's like, no, this is, sure, it's a big deal, but it's not absolutely overwhelming, no. It wasn't completely unexpected. The basic elements were there. It just suddenly they all fit together, you know, in a new, clear way, even simpler. Oh, great. But it's not overwhelming. Not absolutely overwhelming, no. See, the cat walks past me like I don't even exist, not even aware. Because it's looking for the world, you know. It's every sound, everything is out. I'm sitting here silently. So nothing to see there. So here we hear the gospel, which is called the good news. And the good news is so shocking, so stunning, that we spend a lot of time just in the wow of it. Good news, how easy it is to be free. I mean, how easy it is. Oh my gosh. It's like that. could say we're burning off all our karma. That's another way of putting it. Continuity fear, same thing, is that we have all these expectations, all these to make it all believable and pretend. Now we realize we don't have to. So all these expectations that expect us to act in a certain way, we're not doing that. We're just sitting quietly. And this sort of ends up, we feel in the body of like this sort of irritation and strain, like the body says, come on, you gotta do this, think that, and you're not doing it. You're not behaving according to your habitual expectations because the whole game has changed, suddenly changed. But those habitual expectations are still there. You're supposed to think this way. This is what's supposed to motivate you. You're supposed to pretend that it's, you can't get out. You're supposed to believe it's making, that you are trapped. You're supposed to pretend that this is wonderful being trapped. You're supposed to pretend you have this imaginary God explaining how to do it to you. You're supposed to be happy with that. You're supposed to believe that you're happy because this imaginary God has all the answers for you of how to make it this pretense real and how to get God here. And you're supposed to be, you know, going along with that. And you're supposed to, but now you realize, I don't have to do any of that. I don't have to do anything, really. Situation resolves itself, just poof. Situation just resolves itself. Just drop the false premise. Situation just resolves itself. So here I was expecting a few more lifetimes, you know, of struggling. I see, no, it just all can resolve itself right now. Just totally resolve itself right now. Now, in my case, I knew this is my last life go-round with this foolishness. So I'm not expecting anything more. So that helps, and then you gradually diminish it more. This is, you know, try to make it seem like this is my last year at this foolishness. This is my last day. This is my last moment today. And just keep trying to get used to that. This is just all going to resolve itself. Resolve itself simply, easily, just without even having to do anything. Except just drop this false premise. So. This false desire, just drop the desire. Drop the scheme, that's all, and then it just resolves itself. So we could say it's so simple, it's just self-resolving, automatic resolve. We don't have to resolve it. It just falls into resolution easily. Once there's nothing holding it in place, it just all resolves easily. This is what we saw. What those who have experienced this tell us, that eventually it just resolves itself just easily, simply, easily, no problem, no effort at all. Again, keep yourself in this posture of you're not giving ground, you're standing your ground. And you're expecting that resolution will come, absolutely expecting it. Not trying to force it, but accepting is going to just happen on its own easily. When you see the inevitability and the ease of resolution, this is the shock, isn't it? Shock of the unexpected. Let our mind just get used to it. Give the mind an opportunity to get used to it, adjust. It will do so. Keep in mind that many, many could talk a good spiritual game, but the body passes away. They're going to come back again and keep talking the spiritual game. That's very common. So we don't want to do that. This is why we're spending our time like this. And it certainly somewhat interferes with talking good spiritual game, because we're being quiet a lot of the time and humbly suffering from the shock of this. But this is what actually works. So you don't have to come back. You see, you talk a good spiritual game, and you try to convince everybody, I'm free, and then you die, and you say, well, nobody knows. And then you come back again and say, well, nobody knows that I came back again. And, but in my case, what happened was I remembered my past lives, and then so that whole thing was just, boom, blown up. I said, that doesn't work. You can't fool yourself. Yeah, you can fool others, and they don't know who you are, and they think, oh, you just... First time here. Oh yeah, first time here. Yeah, and I've never been here before. What is this place? Oh, nice. And they don't remember your last life of like talking a big spiritual game. They don't remember that, and you don't remember it supposedly. But what happens if you remembered it and say, oh my gosh, that's what I've done. Look at all these lives of me posing, being a posing like an. That doesn't work. I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to do that again. And so then you tend to shy away from that. If somebody was completely cavalier about this type of insight we've just had now, so yeah, I've seen that. Well, they would actually be totally liberated, actually, and the freshness would be there. And you would know, you would absolutely know they're liberated. There's no question about it. And if they're not, then they're just posing. They're just playing the game of this game, Still trying to believe in a trick that hasn't been resolved at its root. They're saying, oh yeah, come on down here, God, there's no problem, easy to get out. But deep down, they don't believe it. They think, no, this is just a marketing ploy that we're trying to use on God. See, there's many this way who are very good spiritual talkers, but it's really, they're just trying to market it to God. Look, guys, no problem. You can get free of this trap, and no problem at all. Come on down. I'm free. I'm no problem. I don't have any problem with it. I can talk about it. It's no problem. But deep down, they still think it is a trap. And they think that their real salvation comes from God being trapped. They still believe it. It's just a way of trying to talk God into it. So we spend our day just burning off as much of this as possible like this. It's just very intense. But we cannot apologize for the intensity because of the times, these times is a very crucial time. Optimal time to get this done, actually. Optimal time. You don't want to wait till later because then it may not be so optimal, actually. Because what's going to happen is there's going to seem like a whole new palette of marketing techniques, you see. And you're told, oh, the problem is you just haven't mastered these marketing techniques. Once we do, then God will be convinced, and then God will be trapped, we'll be free. You just look at all these new marketing, look at this palette, new palette you've got. It's just the possibilities are endless. You can't give up. I mean, you haven't even tried all this stuff. You know, look at all this. And that can easily, submerge your will. It's just like me deciding not to get a smartphone, draw the lines, and no, I understand. This can easily submerge my will, easily. Don't bluff on those things. No, I can recognize it, no. One of the best decisions ever. Now, my phone, I just use it, oh, call, hello, bye, that's it. Occasionally I get a text. Once in a blue moon I might send a picture or something, a lousy picture. Doesn't matter. So it's not in my mind at all. The phone is not in my consciousness at all. So I'm using all of that awareness and attention and consciousness, focusing on this, you see. Because the smartphone is really a plug that plugs you in to everything else. There's an entire palette that's available, emerging now, like an iceberg emerging. And I said, no, I'm not going to plug into that. That just reinforces the belief in the trap and that we can be clever enough to make it work. Google doesn't grab this. I don't know if it grabbed the last one. You don't want to dispute it. They say, if you feel that this copyright violation claim is in error, then you can dispute it. And they say, but if it turns out that your dispute is not genuine, it's not accurate dispute, we have the right to terminate your account. So who in the world is going to dispute anything? Because you don't even know what their parameters are. You have no idea what their parameters are, and you say, well, this is just incidental background, neighbor music. Yeah, I'm not trying to infringe anyone's copyright. But they might say, no, that's not a valid claim that you're making. It's obviously copyright protected. And so then they claim that gives them leverage to terminate your account. So what kind of ombudsmanship is this really at all? It's terrorizing people. You're not told what the parameters are here of dispute, settling dispute. You just claim, I supposed to just say I dispute this and then write a note of why you dispute it. And you don't even know what the judge, what their parameters are of evaluating anything. So who's going to risk terminating their account on that? Nobody. It'd be stupid. So I just, if there's a video that they claim there's something like this background music, I have to leave it off. Leave it off. You cannot, this is the new world order, folks. They say they're totally fair. They say if you dispute this, sure, file a dispute. And they say, but if your dispute turns out to be bogus or incorrect, we have the right to terminate your account, to terminate you, you eventually, So, they say, yeah, you're free. And you got nothing to hide. My world was totally open, totally transparent. Except they don't tell you what the parameters are for making decisions about your dispute. Is that transparent and freeing up? Oh, no, no, no. We have our reasons, you know. You don't know what they are. Well, pressures from above, pressures from the government, pressures from companies, pressures from pressures from lawyers, pressures from all sorts of things. But this is an internal process. So, well, you want to live in a world where your existence is dependent on an internal process that you don't know what it is, and variable changing factors. Is that what you want to base your existence on? That? And they say you have to be a slave. Well, I dispute that because of this. Oh, sure, great, you can dispute it. Of course, if your dispute is seen to fail and you file the claim that was not based on truth and fact the way that we interpret it, then we deserve have the right to terminate you. So there's no better example than this right here. This is the New World Order. This is the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture. And their decisions are based on the internal dynamics of the bureaucracy, and you don't know what they are. This is the same that it's already, you know, it's been test runs like in the various places, Soviet Union, previously the Soviet Union, China, whatever. And you go to court and say, of course you can defend yourself. Of course, if we decide that your defense is not justified, then you forfeit all rights. It's like saying, we're sending you to prison for 30 years. But if you want to dispute this judgment, you're free to do so. But if you fail in your dispute, we find out that it's not a legitimate dispute, you're an heir, then we deserve the right to completely terminate you. And the parameters are internal, and you don't know what they are. And there's no recourse. I mean, what is that? Is that the system we want to live under? This is the system we're living under, actually. This is what is coming. They're getting serious about, you know, hey, we got to get more serious about getting God down here, you know, and so we can get free of this place. And we really got to, everybody's got to get on the same page. Everybody has got to pull this, you know, the same direction. We can't have anybody complaining. We say, well, sure, you can complain, but if it turns out you were just complaining and there wasn't any substance to your complaint, then we're going to terminate you. So then you have like a slave society that claims it's free. It says, what are you talking about? We're not free. What? We're open. We're transparent. We have a system that handles all complaints. We encourage people to complain if they feel it's justified. It's all open and free and transparent. What are you talking about? We have a great society, the best society possible. I say, but if you complain and it's just deemed that the complaint was unjustified, then you got the right to terminate us. And the determinations of whether the complaint was justified or not are due to some internal, totally untransparent matrix, you know, metrics that nobody knows what they are. And you call that a nice, great situation? Interesting. We would call it dictatorship. So, consider this. This is where we're at. And do we really want that? If we want to keep trying to trick God, that's what we're going to have. This is what it's come to now. So if we want to keep up this farce, actually is what it is, that's what it's going to come to. And this is something that I've known all along. I said, wow, this is what's coming. Is they'll tell you you're free. In fact, you're more free than you've ever been because we have all this massive bureaucracy to process your complaints. How fortunate you are. Of course, don't make any false complaints. because we can't tolerate those, obviously. We have to really crack down on that. But as far as complaining goes, sure. In fact, we encourage that, as long as it's not false complaint. Okay, but who determines that it's false complaint? Oh, the bureaucracy that wants everybody to actually not complain. They just won't tell you what their judgments are based on. The judge just rules, says, your complaint has been denied, it's been a false complaint. Off with your head. That's it. Bailiff, take him away. It's kangaroo court. The whole mindset of the cosmic corporate culture that's coming in is they have the answers. Well, of course they have to pretend they have the answers. Otherwise they couldn't be this cosmic corporate culture coming in saying we need to incorporate your world. If they said, well, we don't have the answers, we don't know how to do it, then they'd have a little legitimacy. So of course they're going to say they know how to do it. Of course they're going to believe they know how to do it. Of course they and what they're going to say is, the only problem is you haven't joined us. Once you join us, that's what's going to work. We know that everyone has to join together in this, and so we're just the force, the bureaucracy that's inclusive. We're being inclusive. We're including everybody in this. Once everybody's included, then it's going to work. So see, this bureaucracy, this cosmic corporate culture, this massive bureaucracy. This is how they justify it. They say the answer is everyone. Agree, you know, that this is what we're doing, is all do it the same and that'll work. This is a premise again. It's a desire. It's not true. It's not true. And so this is how they justify it. And they don't even, you know, they think that they question it off with their head. You know, that's a grievance. So they're so scared of any grievance. They say, wait a minute, I'm going to question this off with their head, that they don't dare question it. And then they pass it on to you. You don't dare question this. You can do it once, but if you fail, off with your head. And, you know, people start realizing there isn't any way to question it successfully. They're going to lop your head off. And then, then the bureaucracy says, well, look, nobody's disagreeing, no complaints. It must be wonderful then. It must be working. And this mindset just keeps going and going and going like this. It's like an Autobot. and they don't feel they can question it. So there's another shock. It really is terrible. What's going on here? It really is way more terrible than we realize. Because you'll get into this state that unquestionably you think the answer is to pull everybody else into that state unquestionably. And you don't even dare question the situation at all. And yet you still think that's based on your freedom, free choice, instead of fear. But it's based on fear, actually. And then you project the fears. They know the fear is just the failure of incorporating everybody. But if we succeed in incorporating everybody, the fear will vanish. But that's not the fear. That's not really the fear at all. So it's a misplaced fear. But good luck trying to, you know, tell a cosmic corporate culturist any of this, you know, now. So freedom is gone. I mean, our lives are being run by cosmic corporate culture, actually. And the government really serves as a bureaucratic arm of cosmic corporate culture already. They're just part of the bureaucracy of it, enforcing it. That's all that's happening right now. These information companies and internet companies and all of the new technology, all these huge companies. They're the ones calling the shots, actually. The politicians, everybody else, those are just staff members. They're just a staff, they're just part of the bureaucracy. And if you try to point out the falsity of it, they say, what? You're trying to trap me here. Because their premise is that the only way that they get free of this so-called trap is if they can entrap God. That's the only way. So basically, when you tell them, hey, you don't need to work to try to trap God at all. We don't have to do any of this. They think that you're trying to tell them that they have to be entrapped forever. So of course they're going to be super angry at you. So how do you get out of this, the trap of believing this is how you get out of a trap? Which of course, the more you're working on getting out of the trap, the more you believe there is a trap. Which then creates a negative feedback loop. It makes things worse. Well, how do you get out of that? Well, there's many aspects to it. And one of them for me was seeing my past lives, you know, realizing what I did then didn't work. So you know you have to get down to real tough work. Part of it's suffering. Part of it's realizing it's going to get worse if you don't resolve this. A lot of your willingness to work provides clarity and some help along the way. And so there are these various factors. Saying, hey God, we don't want to be anywhere else. Are you kidding? We're having so much fun here. It's like there isn't anywhere else, baby.